Stephen King is such a huge, prolific author that for the longest time I thought he surely must be dead. Nobody alive can write so many books. Alas, Stephen King is alive and well and working on his next book or three, as we'll come to find out in the next minutes. So let's dig in. Stephen King. Of course, Stephen King wasn't born Stephen King, or Stephen King is not his entire name. Stephen Edwin King is Stephen King's entire name. He was born in Portland, Maine on September 21st, 1947 to Donald and Nellie Ruth Pillsbury King. According to Lisa Rogak's 2009 biography, Haunted Heart, The Life and Times of Stephen King, baby Stephen's birth came as a surprise. Years earlier, Ruth King was diagnosed as infertile, which had led the Kings to adopt Stephen's older brother, David Victor, in 1945, 2 years prior. In the early years of their marriage, Ruth and Donald King were constantly on the move. Donald, a merchant marine, was frequently away from home. As Stephen King writes in his 1981 non-fiction book, Dance Macabre, his father was a fan of horror and science fiction stories and had himself unsuccessfully tried his hand at writing. The discovery of a box of his father's books, which included a volume by horror writer H.P. Lovecraft, would prove a remarkable moment for Stephen King. With the end of World War II, Donald King returned home on a more or less permanent basis and took a job as a door-to-door vacuum cleaner salesman. Although Stephen King has virtually no memories of his father, he has described him as a man with an itchy foot. When the author was only 2 years old, his father left to get a pack of cigarettes and never returned. A walking cliché was his father. Faced with supporting herself, 4-year-old David, and 2-year-old Stephen alone, Nellie Ruth King often relied on the kindness of relatives while searching for work. Constantly on the move in the 9 years after Donald King's untimely departure, Ruth King and her sons found themselves living in Chicago, Indiana, Massachusetts, and Wisconsin. At times, because she didn't have the money, she didn't have the place to stay, she didn't have the money to pay a babysitter, or she was just really poorly being paid or not really paid, Ruth had to leave her two sons with extended families for weeks and sometimes months at a time. At times, Ruth King was forced to work 2 or 3 jobs at a time to put food on the table for her tiny family. When babysitters were too expensive, David and Stephen were left alone reading to each other to pass the time and stay out of mischief. In 1958, the Kings finally found a permanent home in Dorman, Maine, when Ruth's sister Ethelyn gave her a house in which to live in exchange for helping care for their ailing parents. Poverty goes hand in hand with disease, so poor health was on the menu for Stephen King and kept young King home for most of what should have been his first year in elementary school. A case of measles and repeated bouts of strep, which led to a painful ear infection, kept him either in bed or in the doctor's office. The treatments, which involved the repeated lancing of his eardrums, left King rightfully traumatized. When asked if there was an event in his childhood that in some way warped him into writing horror stories, Stephen King said he can't point to any particular incident. However, he has related one horrifying story that occurred when he was 4. In Dance Macabre, King states, "According to Mom, I had gone off to play at a neighbor's house, a house that was near a railroad line. About an hour I left, I came back, she said, as white as a ghost. I would not speak for the rest of the day. It turned out that the kid I had been playing with had been run over by a freight train while playing on or crossing the tracks. My mom never knew if I had been near him when it happened, and although King claims to have no memory of the incident, novelist and psychiatrist Janet Jepson told him, 'You've been writing about it ever since.'" And there is some imagery that comes to mind relating to a railroad and death. Although Stephen King earned a partial scholarship to New Jersey's Drew University, his slim finances kept him in his home state after high school. Instead, he followed his older brother David to the University of Maine at Arno. In college, at the height of the Vietnam War, King was active in campus protests and wrote a column for the campus newspaper called King's Garbage Truck. In his freshman year, he made his first professional sale to Starling Mystery Stories. The short story titled The Glass Floor earned the struggling student a windfall of 35 extremely useful dollars for him at that point in life. To supplement the weekly stipend of $5 his mother sent him, King took a job in the school's library. There, he met the woman who would become his wife, a history major and aspiring poet named Tabitha Spruce. "He really was literally the poorest college student I've ever met in my life," told Tabitha King to Biography in 2000. "He was wearing cut-off gum rubbers because he couldn't afford shoes." In 1970, the couple had a child, a daughter called Naomi. After graduation, King and Spruce married and moved to a trailer in Hermon, Maine. While unsuccessfully searching for a teaching position, King took on a succession of low-paying jobs to make ends meet. The struggling author pumped gas and worked in an industrial laundry. Often depressed, King felt that all he had done with his education was replicate his mother's life. He somehow managed to get a teaching position by 1973, becoming a high school English teacher, drawing a meager $6,400 a year. Unfortunately, his mother, Nellie Ruth, would never see her son's rise to fame as one of the most popular authors of all time. On December the 18th, 1973, just months before the publication of Carrie, she lost a long and torturous battle with cancer. The circumstances of his mother's death would have a profound effect on Stephen King, and in 1978, he would publish the short story The Woman in the Room, told from the perspective of a man who euthanizes his dying mother. King wrote the story as a way of dealing with the complicated emotions he had regarding his mother's illness. Tabitha, his wife, who'd been one of the first to read Stephen's short stories in college, had loaned Stephen her own typewriter and refused to let him take a higher paying job that would mean less time to write. Tabitha was also the one who discovered draft pages of what would become Carrie tossed in Stephen's trash can. She retrieved them and ordered him to keep working on the idea. Ever since, King has continued to pay Tabitha's encouragement forward. He frequently and effusively blurbs books from established as well as new authors, citing a clear wish to leave publishing better than he found it. Meanwhile, Tabitha is a respected author in her own right, as are both of their sons, Joe Hill and Owen King. He's the only author in history to have had more than 30 books become number one bestsellers. He now has more than 70 published books, many of which have become cultural icons, and his achievements extend so far beyond a single genre at this point that it's impossible to limit him to just one. Even though, as the world was reminded in 2017 when the feature film adaptation of It became the highest grossing horror movie on record, horror is still King's calling card. Carrie, which King sold for a $2,500 advance, would go on to earn close to $500,000 for the rights to its paperback run. 2 years after Carrie's publication, Brian De Palma's 1976 film adaptation grossed $33 million on a $1.8 million budget, largely on the strength of advanced critical praise and word-of-mouth reviews. Welcomed by the success of Carrie's paperback sales, King would go on to churn out six novels: Salem's Lot, The Shining, Rage, The Stand, The Long Walk, and The Dead Zone over the next 6 years, establishing a prolificacy that will go on through much of his career.
How the f*** do you write so many books so fast?
"The movie made the book, and the book made me," King told the New York Times in 1979. By 1980, King was the world's best-selling author. The Poorest College Student was the world's best-selling author. Now, at 74 years old, King shows no sign of stopping. Having written over 70 novels and 200 short stories, King continues to produce work that's both relevant and influential. A true icon in an ever-changing entertainment landscape, his enduring popularity is rare for any celebrity and virtually unheard of for a novelist. At the core of King's success as a storyteller is his uncanny ability to channel the essence of ordinary life into extraordinary circumstances. Still, his life didn't get much easier after becoming world famous. For example, in 1991, a crazed fan broke into his house. King managed to experience a real-life horror story so terrifying that it could have been ripped from the pages of one of his books. On the morning of Saturday, April 20th, 1991, King's wife Tabitha discovered 20-year-old Eric Keane of San Antonio, Texas, in their stately Victorian home in Bangor, Maine. Keane was carrying a backpack which he claimed contained a bomb. Tabitha King was alone in the house at the time and fled to a neighbor's home to call the police. When authorities arrived, they discovered Keane, in the King's attic brandishing, what appeared to be a homemade detonator. A police dog caused Keane to drop the device, which was discovered to be fake addictions. In On Writing, a memoir of the craft, Stephen King writes that he took his first drink at age 18 on a high school trip to New York and Washington DC. As is the case with most first-time drinkers, he overdid it and wound up violently ill. Still, alcohol became a regular habit from that moment on. By 1985, King had added an addiction to cocaine to his drinking problem. While on the drug, he would stay up late with his pulse racing dangerously as he wrote. At last, King's wife staged an intervention. Gathering friends and family, Tabitha King confronted the author with his substance abuse and delivered an ultimatum: get clean or get out. Wisely, King chose rehab, and he's been clean and sober since the 1980s, at the height of cocaine popularity. Also, Stephen King has written under two pen names, Richard Bachman and John Sweeten. In 1999, he was hit by a minivan. He suffered several injuries, including a collapsed right lung, multiple fractures in his right leg, scalp lacerations, and a broken hip. During his recovery period, he thought about retiring, but he skipped that, and in change, King and his lawyer bought the van that hit him for $1,500, with King announcing that, yes, we've got the van, and I'm going to take a sledgehammer and beat it. Stephen King tries to write a minimum of 2,000 words a day. That's more than 2 pages a day, with a book a year being the minimum. He prefers to use paper and Waterman fountain pen. He's a fan of AC/DC and the Ramones. He won over 50 awards for his novels. The first was the 1978 American Library Association Best Book for Young Adults with Salem's Lot. He wrote one of his most famous books that became movies, The Shining, while staying at the Stanley Hotel. In 1974, King and his wife were staying in the Stanley Hotel in Estes Park, Colorado. That night, King had a dream. I dreamed of my 3-year-old son running through the corridors, looking back over his shoulder, eyes wide, screaming. He was being chased by a fire hose. I woke up with a tremendous jerk, sweating all over, within an inch of falling out of bed. I got up, lit a cigarette, sat in the chair looking out the window at the Rockies, and by the time the cigarette was done, I had the bones of the book firmly set in my mind. The Stanley Hotel now includes a 30,000 square foot horror film museum in The Shining's honor. King himself is a musician and notably played the guitar in the band Rock Bottom Remainders from 1992 to 2012. Stephen and Tabitha King own Zone Radio, a company that serves to head their 3 radio stations in Maine. One of them, WKIT, is a classic rock station that goes by the tagline Stephen King's rock station. The number 13 gives him chills. When I'm writing, I'll never stop work if the page number is 13 or a multiple of 13. I'll just keep on typing till I get to a safe number. When I'm reading, I won't stop on page 94, 193, or 382, since the sums of these numbers add up to 13. King also has a fear of flying and will often take his motorcycle for book tours, saying that I travel by plane when I have to, I travel by car when I possibly can. He's an insanely avid reader and says he gets through 70 to 80 books a year, mostly fiction. His home library includes more than 17,000 books, and he claims to have read all of them, excepting the new editions. The author is worth close to $500 million and has sold more than 350 million copies of his books. And that's all on Stephen King. Hopefully you've read at least one of his books, watched at least 10 of his movies. Subscribe, share, like, comment, and read a Stephen King book. That's all for today. I'm Alex, and until next time, beware of falling apples.